In the last lesson, we focused mostly on math operators. Numbers are important, but we need to construct larger and more complex logic operations like, hey, is my shape a circle or is it colored red? We also need to perform bit manipulations, and that's what we're going to cover in this lesson. The goal for this lesson is to finish up our understanding of Java operators. We need to cover the equality operators, logical operators, bit operators, and then we're going to take a final look at the operator precedence. Equality and relational operators check to see how two values are related. These operators all return a Boolean value. Now remember, a Boolean value is either true or false. So each one of these evaluates to either true or false. To determine if two values are equal, we use two equal symbols for equality. This is different than the assignment operator. That only uses one sign, and it's a common mistake to use one equal sign when you meant two. Luckily, Java's going to complain about that when you try to compile. I'll show you that when we get to the code. In this example, is equal would return false. We can also test if two values are not equal. That uses the exclamation point with the equal sign. We read that as A is not equal to B. If they're not equal, the test returns true. This is the opposite of the equality operator. 1 not equal to 2 would return true. We use the greater than and the less than symbols to test for strict inequalities. A strict inequality says, is A strictly greater than B? The answer is always, again, true or false. So if A equals B, then the strict inequality is false. For this example, 1 greater than 2 will be false, while 1 less than 2 will be true. If both values were 1, greater than 1 is false. The not so strict version is A greater than or equal to B? So, or is A less than or equal to B? In this case, we're allowing equals to return true as well. So if A equals B, then the operator returns true. We use an equal symbol with the greater than or less than symbol for these operators. Let's look at assigning Booleans to equality and relational operators. So if we set A equals to 3 and B equals to 4, let's see what happens for each operator. Equals is false, not equals is true, greater than is false, greater than or equal is false, less than is true, and less than or equal is to true. Now let's set A and B equal to 4 and run it again. In this case, equals is true, not equals is false. Greater than is false, greater than or equal is true. This is because the two values are equal, so that counts as true in this test. Less than is false, and less than or equal is true. Now I said earlier it was a common mistake to use a single equals. Let's see what happens if I delete one of the equal signs in the first test. It won't even compile. It complains with int cannot be converted to a Boolean. That's because it's actually trying to do the assignment chaining we saw in the last lesson. It's setting A equal to B, then trying to assign it to the Boolean value. Int's not a Boolean, so we get an error. Next up are the conditional operators. Conditional operators perform logical operations on Boolean values. You may know these as and or. And is the first one we're going to look at. It reads like an English statement, A and B. If A is true and B is true, A and B is true. If either one of them are false, then A and B is false. Both A and B must be true for the result to be true. Or also reads like an English statement, A or B. If A is true, or if B is true, then A or B is true. If A and B are both false, then A or B is false. Only one, either A or B, needs to be true for the result to be true. Finally, there's one unary operator we didn't cover in the last lesson. It's called not. So if B is true, not B is false. If B is false, not B is true. Basically, the not just flips the sign of the Boolean value. We use an exclamation point in front of the Boolean value or for the expression for nots. Whenever you see the exclamation point, you can substitute the word not. Let's look at the Boolean operators. Assume A is true and B is true. Here's what and or not look like. Now let's make B false. Here's what and or not look like. Now the power of Boolean expressions is that we can chain several of these together. We can also use equality and relational expressions. So assume A is true and B is 4 greater than 3. Let's play with that a bit. Now, these can get pretty long. The equality operators will be evaluated first, then the ands, then the ors. You really don't want to string them together like this, however. It's not intuitive to know which operators have precedence. You'll want to be explicit about the order statements are evaluated. To do so, use parentheses. We'll look at this closer in a minute. Finally, we have the bit operators. These operators are for changing the individual bits of an integer number. Remember, integers include bytes, shorts, ints, and longs. The first group of bit operators that we'll look at are the bitwise operators. The bitwise operators are for AND, OR, and exclusive OR. These take two integer types and return an integer or a long. That's important. If you use these operations on two bytes or two shorts, your result's going to be an integer. The result is always an int or a long unless you cast it back down. The bitwise operators are similar to the Boolean operators we saw before. In fact, you can mentally think of these operations as one is true and zero is false as you work through each bit in the number. We call a bit that has a one as set and a zero as clear. The bitwise operators use a single ampersand for the for, a single bar for the or, and a caret symbol for a new operation we call exclusive or. Let's assume that we have two bits and we want to AND. We're saying if the first bit is 1 and the second bit is 1, then the result from an AND is 1. If we had a 1 and a 0, the result is a 0. ANDs want both to be a 1, otherwise it's a 0. We can extend this for every bit in a byte. If we AND each of the 8 bits in A and B, we get the following result. We get set bits only in the positions where A and B bits were also set. ORs are a little different. For an OR, we're saying if the first bit is a 1 or the second bit is a 1, then the result of an OR is 1. If they're both a 1, it's still a 1. For ORs, the answer is a 1 unless both initial bits are a 0. Again, this can be extended to a whole integer. Here, if we OR each of the 8 bits in A and B, we get the following result. We get bit set only in positions where there is a bit set in A or B. Exclusive OR is spelled XOR and uses the caret symbol. This behaves like an OR, except that if both are a 1. In this case, if both are a 1, the result is 0. It's like the Highlander bit operator. There can only be 1. It's exclusive. Well, that's how I remember it. Here, if we XOR each of the 8 bits in A and B, we'll get the following result. We get bits set only in the positions where a bit was set in only A or only B, but not both. One unary operation we skipped in the last lesson is a bitwise unary not. We skipped it because I wanted to keep all the bit manipulating operations together. The unary not flips all the bits in your integer. So, if the bit is 1, it becomes 0, and vice versa. Here, if we not each of the 8 bits in A, all the bits get flipped. Set bits become clear bits, and clear bits become set bits. Let's look at some of the code for this, and hopefully it'll become clear. We'll work with integers. We'll set our first number to all 1s. The second number will be half 1s and half 0s. If we AND the numbers, we get back a number with half 1s and half 0s, basically the same number we got back. If we OR the numbers, we get all the bits set. This is because all the bits are set in the first number. Things are a little bit more interesting for XOR. When we run this, we get the reverse of the second number. Look at what happens if we set the first number to 42, and then we set the second number to 24. We XOR the two numbers, and we get 50. Okay, well, we then XOR 50 with the second number again, and we get back to 42. You can do this with any two numbers. It's pretty cool. And for completeness, Here's how we flip the bits using not. These operators are used for bit shifts. What does that mean? It means we move all the bits to the left or the right, depending on the direction of the arrows. The direction the symbol points determine the direction of the shift. If we are shifting to the right, the most significant digit in the number determines what's shifted in. So if the highest digit is 1, we shift 1 into the number. If it's a 0, we shift 0. The reason for this is we're keeping the number either positive or negative. As you remember, the highest bit determines the sign of the number. We saw that in how the computers store negative numbers lesson. Sometimes we always want to shift a 0 into the number, so for that we use the unsigned shift right. That has 3 greater than symbols. A 0 is always shifted in. Again, let's play with these in code. We'll take a number and shift it to the left. The cool thing to note here is the result is just the previous number times 2. So when you shift left, each shift is a power of 2. If we shifted by 2, the number multiplied is by 4. Shifting right is just going in the opposite direction. Let's do one negative number and one positive number. As you can see, the shifting keeps the sign. If we do it again with the unsigned shift, you see the sign changes for the negative number. That's because we shifted a 0 in, making it positive. If you want to see more bit operations, check out 4 ways to count bits in a byte. Manipulating bits is a common interview question, although the types of programs you work on will really determine how often you work with bits. The last thing we wanted to discuss was operator precedence. We covered all the Java operators individually. You can chain many of these into larger, more complex operations. The catch is, Java will perform operations in a specific order. It's not always left or right. Here's the list of operator precedence. The way to read this chart is, Java is going to start from the top and work its way down. If the operators are on the same line, it'll work from left to right. Again, you want to use parentheses to make this explicit. It's not a good practice to chain long operations without parentheses if your expression is really long. You might want to break it up into smaller statements like this. That way, there's no ambiguity in what you're trying to calculate. Parentheses always go first. And that wraps it up for the different operators. We now have the power to control our numbers down to the bit level. We can form complex Boolean expressions using our logical operators, and we know how to test for equality. We can start using these operators to build bigger and bigger programs. Programs that actually do something. You'll want to play with these in your own Java programs. It's easier to understand when you see what happens in code. If you have any questions, leave them in the comments below or on dju.com. And I'll see you in the next lesson. Hey, thanks for watching the video. There's a quick quiz for this on dju.com if you'd like to gauge how much you learned. If you like the videos you're seeing, please let me know by liking the video and hitting the subscribe button for the DGU channel on YouTube. I'd really appreciate that. If you have concerns or questions, please leave them in the comments below or on dgu.com. There's a poll on the front page of dgu.com, so you can also let me know what topic gets covered next. Thanks for watching and see you in the next video.